Now, this is the tribute. If somebody paid such a tribute to the Quran, I can't imagine a Muslim scholar bettering it. Now, prepare for the shock. I said, prepare for the shock. From these 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they say, yet the King James Version has grave defects. And that these defects are so many and so serious. These are not my words. They are so many and so serious as to call for revision in the English translation. Calls for revision in the revised text. And in the revision, the kingpin of the evangelist, the preacher, the hot gospeler, the Bible thumper, John 3:16. No Christian preacher is worth the name if he can't clinch the deal with John 3:16. John 3:16. For God so loved the world, in the authorized King James Version, that he gave his only begotten son. My brother Swagat changed the word begotten to unique. This is not from the King James Version. The King James Version says begotten. I heard Brother Swagat on TV, or was it video? This morning, there he's speaking to a group as if it was his own church group, you know, giving some lessons on Babylon. I think it was on that or another one. He used the word begotten this morning. And in 8 hours' time, he changed it to unique. I'm asking, are you ashamed of the word begotten? Are you ashamed of it, that Jesus is the only begotten son? And Brother Swagart, in one of these 30 books that I had to purchase in South Africa before coming, these are his books. More than 30 I purchased, and I went through each and every one of them. I had to. I want to know what my brother is talking about. What does he really believe in? Because generally when you speak to a Christian, every Christian happens to be unique, absolutely unique. As soon as you corner him somewhere, he says, but I don't believe in that. As soon as you corner him somewhere, he says, I don't believe in that. And everyone of these 1,000,000,000, anyone I meet, he's unique. Everyone is unique. He belongs to the Church of England, but he doesn't, you know, believe in what the Church of England teaches. He belongs to the Roman Catholic Church, but he doesn't really believe what the Roman Catholic Church teaches. Everyone is unique. So I said, now let me see now, what does he say in black and white? And in black and white, I found that he uses this John 3:16, and in his quotation, in his book, he says begotten. Tonight, he says unique. Can you see the reason? The reason is obvious. The Muslims have been taking exception to these terms. In the Holy Quran, we are told, Lam yalid wa lam yulad, that God Almighty, he does not beget and is not begotten. And there is nothing like unto him. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Then again, in very strong terms, the Quran condemns this idea that God begot a son, because begetting is an animal act. It belongs to the lower animal functions of sex, and we are not to attribute such a quality to God. As the Christian says in his catechism, he says, Jesus is the only begotten son, begotten, not made. And I have been asking Christians, please explain, what are you really trying to emphasize when you say begotten, not made? What are you really trying to tell me? And believe me, in 40 years, no Englishman with the name has opened his mouth to me to explain to me what this word means, begotten. It had to be an American. It had to be an American. He was on a visit to Durban, and he came on a guided tour of the mosque, and I happened to be a guide. And discussing, it came up, I said, now, what does it mean? What are you trying to tell me? What does it mean to say begotten, not made? He said, it means, this American tells me, it means sired by God. I said, what? He said, no, I don't say that. This is what it means. And believe me, that is what it means. Begotten, not made, means sired by God. I said, is that what you believe that God did? He said, no, I didn't say that. This is what it means. So the Muslim has taken strong exception to such an expression about God, that God begot a son. It's according to your language, your catechism. The Roman Catholic Catechism, the Anglican Catechism, the Methodist Catechism, the Lutheran Catechism. You accept this. The statement, begotten, not made. So not like Adam. Adam was made by God. Every dog, pig, and donkey was made by God. As such, metaphorically, he is the father of everything. But he said, no, Jesus is not like that. He is begotten, not made. I said, please explain. And no explanation. So this was something which the Muslims took exception to. And the 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they threw it out to appease us. Did the Muslims threaten you that, look, if you don't take that word out of the Bible, we won't supply you oil? Did they do that? The Arabs? Did they tell you no oil if you don't take this word out from the Bible? Why did you take it out? Because it was an interpolation. It was not the word of God. The Bible you are carrying, it has this interpolation. And you said this morning, I heard the tape, you said one word, even one word. It says if it is not supposed to be there and it's there, it says the whole book should be thrown away. Whole book. But it's not only one word. There are chunks and chunks of it, according to your revises. And Brother Swaggart tells me in one of his books that if you want to know anything factual, knowledge on any subject, you go to the experts. And he gives an example that if you want to know something about geology, you go to the geologist. If you want to know about the Bible, where do you go? To the barber, shoemaker? No, you go to the Bible experts, the Bible scholars, and they are telling you that this is a fabrication. Then, the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Brother Swaggart also quotes ad verbatim from the first epistle of John, chapter 5, verse 7, where it says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. If he gives me time, he said, now look, which book? I can open it and show it to you. Which book? Ad verbatim, his quotation. I said, look, but it's not in my Bible. Is this not the word of God? In my Bible, it's not there. Why is it not there? Because your scholars, 32 scholars of the highest eminence, Bible scholars, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they say this is another fabrication, another interpolation. So they also threw it out without any ceremony. So, two. And I give you the ascension. Brother Swaggart quotes in his book, Mark chapter 16, verse 16, another place, Mark chapter 16, verse 19. I say, it's not in my Bible. I didn't print this. The Jews didn't print it. The Hindus didn't print it. You Christians, you produced this book. And you are telling me that this is the most up-to-date Bible, going to the most ancient manuscripts. So I look up for Mark chapter 16. I see it ends at verse 8. 9 to 20 is missing. Did I take it out? The Muslims took it out? No. 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they thought it fit that this is another fabrication imposed upon Christendom. And they also threw it out. It's not in my Bible. Therefore, it is not the word of God. If this is the word of God, then that is not the word of God. But I pick up another Bible. Look at this. Look at these two. Brother Swaggart, identical. Look at them. I see back again. It's inside. What was thrown out? The ascension. There are only two places in the Gospels. In the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there are only two places where ascension is mentioned. Mark chapter 16, verse 19. Luke chapter 24, verse 51. Thrown out of this version. Thrown out as fabrication. Ascension. And yet these Bibles, each and every one of them, they tell us that Jesus, when he went to Jerusalem, he rode the donkey into Jerusalem, Matthew says. Mark says he rode the donkey into Jerusalem. Luke says he rode the donkey into Jerusalem. John says he rode the donkey into Jerusalem. Look, God Almighty didn't miss that out. His son riding the donkey into Jerusalem. When every Tom, Dick, and Harry was riding donkeys into Jerusalem. That he didn't forget. But the ascension is not mentioned not once. And where it is mentioned is now thrown out. But I buy another Bible, identical Bible, that's to the look, printed by the same printers. I look, and it's there again. What was thrown out, they put it back again. How come? How come? What games are you people playing? Look at this. Back again. This is the 1971 version. Back again. The ordinary people, poor people, they don't know what's going on. What game is being played? Who knows? You read the preface. The learned man, the preacher, he reads the preface, but he won't tell his congregation what he's reading in the preface. In the preface, we are told that individuals and two church denominations, they stampeded them, they forced them that they should put it back. If not, they're going to preach against this book to say, look, don't buy this, buy the King James Version. Don't buy this, buy the King James, the most up-to-date Bible, going to the most ancient manuscripts. No, don't touch that. This is the safer one, because it has everything that you want to preach, to catch the fish. It's easier to catch the fish with this than with this, the bait. You know, the fish, you know, uses, like Dale Carnegie, he tells us in his book, how to win friends and influence people. He says, I like strawberry and cream. I think most Americans do. But he said, when I go fishing, I put a worm to catch the fish. It's not that I love worms, but this is what the fish loves. So I put worm. So now, if you want to catch fish, you've got to use the right bait. Ascension is now restored to the text, says the preface. Why? Not God told them so. God doesn't speak freely to those scholars as freely as he happens to speak, as brother claims, with him. You know, again and again you read, God comes to him, speaks to him, and he says, son, again, son, which he didn't address his own son, Jesus, in inverted commas. He never called him son, he speaks in the third person. He says, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. But to brother Swaggart, he says, my son, not so freely. So I says, look, this is not the word of God. We say, playing, they said that the church groups, and they, by the meantime, while this was being discovered, they made a net profit of $15 million on this version before they could remove it. $15 million. Brother Swaggart has written some beautiful books. Beautiful books. Incest. Pornography. Homosexuality. Alcohol. Sodom and Gomorrah. And I can't imagine myself doing any better. Beautiful writings. Incest. This is the dark stain on our society, American society. The dark stain on American society. It has reached epidemic proportions. Incest. In my country, the whites of South Africa, according to statistics, 8% of all white people, they commit incest. 8%, one in every 12, is committing incest. I don't know what's the percentage here, but Brother Swaggart tells us that it has reached epidemic proportions in your mighty country, America. And he gives examples from the Holy Bible that there are 10 cases of incest in the Holy Bible. I didn't know that. I knew that in the first book of the Bible, Genesis, there were 4 cases. Brother Swaggart's book enlightens me, I got the 5th one in the first book. As if this is a textbook on incest, to tell you what types of incest you can commit. In a book of God, 10 cases of incest. And I'm told that the type of food you eat junky foods, you become a junkie, you read junky stuff, your mind becomes junky. This type of things you read. Can't you see we are getting programmed? Whatever you see, whatever you read, we are getting programmed. You read about incest, incest, incest. Father with his daughters, son with his mother. Father-in-law with his daughter-in-law. Brother with his sister. What is this? 10 cases of incest. You read about incest, incest, incest. Little wonder that it has reached epidemic proportions. You see, Dr. Vernon Jones, and an American psychologist of great repute. He carried out experiments on groups of school children to whom certain stories were being read. And he said that these stories made certain slight but permanent changes in character, even in the narrow classroom situation. The type of stories that you read, the type of stories that they read, the things that they see, that is the type of mentality they're going to have. So I said, Book of God, why would God Almighty go out of his way in his holy book to reveal to you 10 cases of incest coupling? 10 cases. So I said, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, this is not the word of God. The first 5 books, supposed to be the books of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. These revisers, scholars of the highest eminence, they are telling us today that Moses didn't write the books. He didn't write the books. He's not the author. He's the author, Genesis, author, the first book of Moses in inverted commas. Exodus, second book of Moses in inverted commas. Leviticus, third book of Moses in inverted commas. Numbers, fourth book of Moses in inverted commas. Deuteronomy, fifth book of Moses in inverted commas. I'm asking, why the inverted commas? What for? Why these inverted commas? They are telling you in a very, very diplomatic, psychological way that these are not our words, we don't believe so, but the common man, the laity, the preachers, the Bible thumpers, the hot gospelers, this is what they believe. That these are the books of Moses, but Moses didn't write them. We don't believe that these are his words, so we put them in inverted commas. It's not the book of Moses. There are more than 700 times in these 5 books you read the expression, and the Lord said unto Moses, and Moses said unto the Lord, and the Lord said unto Moses, and Moses said unto the Lord. Neither the Lord said this, nor did Moses write it. English, this is your language. This is written in the third person. Not by God, not by Moses. If Moses wrote it, he would have said, the Lord said unto me, and I said unto the Lord. The Lord says, I said unto Moses, and Moses said unto me. This is in the third person, and that somebody else is writing about these things. It is not the word of God. It is not even the words of Moses. With regards to the obituary, I found out from Jewish scholars that Jewish prophets didn't write the obituaries. You know, before dying, he says, you know, on my tombstone, you put these words, epitaphs. Jews didn't do that. In the book of Deuteronomy, it says, my brother admits that it could be the works of Joshua. But they're supposed to be the books of Moses. How does Joshua fit in? It says, and there Moses died in the land of Moab. Died in the past tense. Over against Beth Peor. And no man knoweth of his sepulchre unto this day. And Moses was. He was 120 years old when he died. Of course, God can do anything. God can do anything. In an explanation about the contradictions in the Bible, whether Satan provoked David or the Lord provoked David, he said, look, this is, we attribute it to God. That though the devil did it, we say God did it. On that basis, would we be prepared to concede that God had those 6 million Jews incinerated because Hitler did it? We say because God intended it. This is what he wanted to do. So God is responsible for the massacre or the incineration of 6 million Jews, or even 600,000, or even 6,000 is dramatic enough. If Hitler did it, could he say God did it? Are you going to blame God for that? You're going to exonerate Hitler and the Nazi party because you say God did it? No, dear brother Swaggart, we don't think like that. If a criminal does such and such a thing, we say it is his action, he's responsible. We don't say God did it. Because eventually the power comes from God, but God has given you that free will to think and to see right from wrong. So if you do wrong, you are responsible. You can't hold God responsible. So either David was provoked by the Satan or by the Lord. And Satan and Lord are not synonymous terms in any religion. They are opposites. Satan and the God Almighty are opposite things. Pornography. Very strong. Brother Swaggart is very strong in his condemnation. and I'm with him. Pornography, any type, whether in written form, whether in pictures or in films, it's a horrible thing. In his book, Brother Swaggart gives you his research, his study. Number one, he says, when you read or you see these things, it acts like a drug. Like marijuana or opium or heroin or alcohol, it acts like a drug. You see these things, it's a chemical action takes place. And I agree with Brother Swaggart. Chemical actions takes place. You know? So you read about ins up with pornography. Pornography. Your mind is getting used to that. Escalation takes place. Desensitization takes place. These are his terms. First time I'm learning these terms. And you must then play the role, act out the role. This is how this sickness, this disease overpowers man. Strong in his condemnation. He is closest to my government in South Africa, because if I take any of some of the magazines that I can buy at Kennedy Airport or at Heathrow, anywhere, if I take it into my country, I go to jail for 2 years. That's how good. That's my country, South Africa. You know, it has its, you know, this the other side of the picture, but as far as religion goes, as far as religiosity goes, they are very, very staunch Christians. But that country of mine banned portions of the Bible. There was a pamphlet in circulation with extracts, 9 extracts from the Holy Bible. And somebody sent it to the censorship board. Said, look at this. What is this? So they made a decree that this pamphlet is banned, not knowing that these are words from the Holy Bible. These were extracts from the Holy Bible, from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 23. I dare any preacher read it to the congregation. I dare any evangelist to read it to his mother, his sister, his daughter, or even to his fiance if she's a good woman. Ezekiel, chapter 23. The whoredoms of those two sisters, Ahola and Aholibah. The language. So do it. My government banned it, and there were 2 ministers of the church on the board when they banned it. But they didn't know they were banning extracts from the Holy Bible. My government is so staunch that they had banned Lady Chatterley's Lover. It's a novel, Lady Chatterley's Lover. It had one offensive word, 4-letter word, one word for which they banned it for 20 years. But now they've grown big, they're mature now, they have allowed it. You know, they have desensitized it, they have withdrawn that order against the book. But 9 extracts from the Holy Bible, say, the book of God, which you are ashamed to read to your audience, I dare my brother, I dare him to read this pamphlet. I have it here ready. He doesn't have to even open the book. Here, all those wordings in red, I said, look, with your usual charismatic language, with the usual actions, I would love to see Brother Swaggart. I feel ashamed to bribe him. I said, look, Brother Swaggart, if you can read it to the audience, I give you $100. What is $100 to Brother Swaggart? When I'm reading in his book on Roman Catholicism, that he needs $291,000 a day to keep his head above water. I calculated 106 million a year just to keep above water. And in the Evangelist of December 85, he's aspiring, I wish him luck, he's aspiring for $1 million a day. He needs, he says, $1 million a day. So good luck to him. But now, if I said I give you 1,000, Brother Swaggart, I give you 1,000, you know, I can't tempt him, I know. But in his usual spirited way, I hope and I pray that he has the courage, the guts, which all the priests in my experience have not had. Read it to your audience. Ezekiel chapter 23. If you can't, and I can tell you that it is not the word of God. The Bible is not the word of God. Yes, there's some mention was made. It was from my book. Is the Bible God's word? I had some 10,000 sent to the city, and I think they're available I don't know whether they'll be given out here. I had instructed them, give to everybody. Let them go home and look at it themselves and read for themselves and make up their own minds. In this book, contradiction. The Quran tells us, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. He said, do they not consider the Quran with care? وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ إِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Had it been from anyone other than Allah, you would have found in it many discrepancies, many contradictions. The Quran is not involved this evening. But this is what the Quran says, that if this is not the word of God, you will find in any book claiming to be from God, that book will be free from contradictions. Like, for example, the example the brother gave, I repeat that. I said, look, it says in one of the books, Solomon had 4,000 stalls of horses. Another one says he had 40,000 stalls of horses. And 4 and 40 is only the difference of a zero. So you'd say, I said, you know, my cousins, the Jews, they didn't know the zero when they wrote the book. They didn't know. It's my Arab brothers who found it from my fathers in India and they shared it with the world, zero. The Jews didn't know. They wrote this in words. 4, F-O-U-R, 4, in Hebrew, of course. 40, F-O-R-T-Y, 40. I said, now who made the mistake? God or the writer? And they were not saved. We are told that they were not saved from mistakes. Mrs. Ellen G. White, you say she's a cultist, Mrs. Ellen G. White, the prophetess of the Seventh-day Day Adventist movement. In her Bible commentary, she says, she has no motives to lie. She believes in the Bible to be the inspired word of God. And yet she says, the Bible we read today is the work of many copyists who have in most instances done the work with marvelous accuracy. In most instances, they have done their work with marvelous accuracy. But copyists have not been infallible. And God most evidently has not seen fit to preserve them altogether from error. God didn't see fit. In other words, this is his business, God's business. If he wants to see fit, if he wants to do a thing, he does it. If he doesn't, he says, look, go to hell. That's your business. He said, God didn't see fit to preserve them from making errors. In transcribing, in the following pages of her commentary, Mrs. White testifies further, I saw that God had specially guarded the Bible. God had specially guarded the Bible. I'm asking for what? Yet, when copies of it were few, learned men had in some instances changed the words in the original manuscripts. They changed the words, thinking that they were making it plain, when in reality they were mystifying that which was plain, by causing it to lean to the established views which were governed by tradition. Like the Jehovah's Witnesses. They have produced a translation called the New World Translation. The Orthodox, you don't accept that. Why don't you? Because they have their own leanings. According to their own ideas, they are changing the words. Same thing that the Protestants did. They were people who believed in Jesus as God. So they said now, they change the words. So we said this has been going on from the very beginning. They boast about 24,000 manuscripts. Brother Swaggart, you know no two are identical. Your scholars say out of the 24,000 that you are boasting about, no two are identical. Then how do you come to know that this is the word of God and this is not out of the 24,000? On the very face of it, when you open the book, the Injil and the Torah you're talking about, it says Matthew begins, in your version, the King James version, it says, the gospel according to Saint Matthew, the gospel according to Saint Mark, the gospel according to Saint Luke, the gospel according to Saint John. I'm asking, what is this according? What is this according to? Why according to? I have got Brother Swaggart's book. It says, homosexuality, its cause and its cure, by Jimmy Swaggart, or just Jimmy Swaggart. It doesn't say according to Jimmy Swaggart. Why this in the book of God? According to. You know why? Because Matthew didn't sign his name. Luke didn't sign his name. Mark didn't sign his name. John didn't sign his name. These are assumed anonymous books. Anonymous books. Attributed to God. I said, this is not the Injil. You see, even in your Arabic translations of these books, Arabic translations, it says Injile Matthew means the Gospel of Matthew, Injil is used. Injile Marcus, Injile Lucas, Injile Yohanna. The one we believe in is Injile Isa, the Gospel of Jesus, what he preached. That is what we believe in as from God. And the script. When you look at these books, Matthew, Mark, it says these are the Injil or the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We believe in the Gospel of Jesus, the one that he preached. And we are told by Matthew that he went to a certain place and he preached the gospel. Mark says he went to a certain other place and he preached the gospel. Luke says he went to a certain place and he preached the gospel. John says he went to another place and he preached the gospel. I said, did he have a book under his arm? Did he have a book under his arm? No. Whatever he preached was from God. That is what we believe in. If you can produce a document called Injile Isa, the Gospel of Jesus, we would be very happy to give it a recognition, to find out and verify whether it is from God and accept it as such. But what you have is Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and J.B. Phillips, a prebendary of the Chichester Cathedral in England, a page servant of the Anglican Church. When writing about Matthew, in his preface he says, early tradition ascribed this gospel to the Apostle Matthew. Early tradition, that's what people said. But scholars nowadays almost all reject this view. Which scholars? Jewish scholars? Hindu scholars? Muslim scholars? No. Christian scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they say that Matthew didn't write Matthew. They say, it says the author whom we may still conveniently call Matthew. Conveniently, why conveniently? Because instead of me telling you the first book of the New Testament, chapter 9, verse 9, the first book of the New Testament, chapter 5, verse 17, I'm wasting your time and mine too. So he says, no. I say Matthew 9, 9, Matthew 5, 17, conveniently, I'm using the term Matthew. He says the author whom we may still conveniently call Matthew has plainly drawn on the mysterious Q, again in inverted commas. That stands for the German word Quelle, sources, which might have been a collection of oral traditions. He has used Mark's gospel freely. In the language of the school teacher, he was copying wholesale from Mark. Matthew, an eyewitness and a ear witness to the happenings with Jesus, one of his disciples, his apostles. He goes and copies a 10-year-old boy who wasn't there. Does it make sense to you? A man who is an eyewitness and a ear witness, a companion of Jesus. He goes and copies a 10-year-old boy who wasn't there. Does it make sense to you? And you say, this is the word of God. The genealogy. Between Matthew and Luke, we are given 66 fathers and grandfathers to Jesus. In a genealogy of 66 fathers and grandfathers, except for one name, no two names are identical. Separate list. Everyone is a different name. Brother Swaggart says, one is the genealogy of Mary and one of Jesus. I say, why of Mary? Does the book say that? No. The book says this is the genealogy of Jesus Christ. The other one ends with Jesus Christ. There's no Mary inside. 66 names, no two are alike except one. And the father of Jesus Christ, allegedly, God Almighty, he's not there. Can you imagine? God Almighty dictating the genealogy of his son in inverted commas. And yet he leaves himself out. He's going out of his way to dictate two genealogies with 66 names and he's not in it. He's not there. I'm asking, what is he trying to tell you? What is he really trying to tell you? When his name is not there. A man who had no genealogy, we believe. No genealogy. He was born miraculously without any male intervention. You give him 66 fathers and grandfathers and you say this is God Almighty dictated. He says, we Muslims, Brother Swaggart, we take strong exception to this type of handling of this mighty messenger of God. We say he was a mighty messenger of God. He was born miraculously. The Holy Quran testifies to that. It has made 1,000 million Muslims in the world today without any kind of proof from the Christians to believe that Jesus Christ was born miraculously and he was the Messiah. He was the word which God bestowed upon Mary. I will be dealing with this subject tomorrow night as Muhammad, the natural successor to Christ. And I'll be open to further questions besides the questions this evening. So with these words, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I am very, very grateful to the community here for creating such an opportunity for me to share the platform with the greatest charismatic speaker in the world today, Brother Jimmy Swaggart. I think it's a privilege and an honor for me.
And now, for 10 minutes, Reverend Jimmy Swaggart.
I look at the Bibles that Mr. Didat has, and from the Quran, Surah, what we call chapter 62 and 5, it says, as the likeness of the ass carrying books, as the donkey is unaware of the value of the load on its back, so some men are ignorant of the spiritual treasure they hold in their hands. What does the Bible produce? That is the ironclad evidence, what it produces. I was in Africa a short time ago, and I was with a group of ministers, and I was being introduced to them and speaking with them. And I asked, or I didn't ask him, but he was asked, how did you become a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ? You see, Jesus cannot be the Messiah and a great prophet and a liar at the same time. He is either who he said he was, or he's a liar. And he's not a liar. Amen. He said, this is the way I became a minister of the gospel. He said, one of my closest friends was a Christian. We argued incessantly over Islam and Christianity. One day, the young Christian said, there's a demon-possessed man, you know, in St. Mark, chapter 16 and verse 17, it says, in my name they'll cast out devils. This is a book of power. Millions upon millions have been healed by the power of God by invoking that mighty name of Jesus. Millions have been changed instantly from the worst bondages that hell could ever produce, such as he mentioned, by the power of the word of Almighty God. I remind you that no dead book could produce those type of results. You can go in our church, and over half the people there were former alcoholics, drug addicts, every bondage that hell could muster. And I know your religion of Islam believes in hell, but tonight they are free by the power of Almighty God, set free in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The gospel of Jesus Christ produces results. It breaks the bondages of sin. It fills the empty heart. He said, I went with him. He was going to pray for this man, demon-possessed, a maniac. He said, when we arrived, he was frothing at the mouth. He said, I've never seen anything like it. And he said, my friend prayed for him with no visible results. And he went to get another minister, and I was left alone with this maniac. And he said, I think I will pray for him myself. And he said, he prayed in the name of Mohammed, come out of him. I ask him, what happened? Nothing. He prayed several times in the name of Mohammed, come out of him. And I do not mean that disrespectfully of Mohammed. He could have prayed in the name of Abraham or Moses, and it would have done no better. He could have prayed in the name of Paul or Peter, and it would have done no better. So standing there alone, he says, I think I'll try it. My Christian friend has said it, and I don't believe it, but I'm going to try it. He laid hands on him. In the name of Jesus Christ, come out of him. He said, Brother Swaggart, before my eyes, he was delivered by the power of Almighty God. I know that you do not deny the miracles of Jesus. But I remind you as I close this, a dead man cannot produce miracles. I want to say it again. A dead man cannot produce miracles. Jesus Christ is alive. I've got 2 minutes. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. One day, very soon, you see, he's promised to come back. He's coming. Because he said he would come. Every single prophecy in this book that is supposed to be fulfilled has been fulfilled. Yes. Amen. The others that have not yet been fulfilled will be fulfilled. There is a hunger in the heart of every person for God. Only Jesus Christ can fill that hunger because God is love. He loves you. This book says he is. He loves you in spite of the sin and the iniquity. He loves you and he wants to make himself real to you. He's not distant, far away, unapproachable. But through Jesus Christ, you can approach him and love him and worship him and he will love you. Because his book says that he does. Thank you.
Let us acknowledge both these fine gentlemen. Let us acknowledge both of them.